A person probing the universe he lives in will encounter 250 billion galaxies, each the home of about 300 billion stars. Every one of these magnificent systems operates in accordance with specific laws and in a particular order. There is a plan, a design, and a balance in every part of the universe.
Hello, Professor Dawkins. How are you? I'm Ben Stein. I'm so sorry to keep you waiting. How are you?
Fine, thank you.
Well, how did it start?
Nobody knows how it started. We know the kind of event that it must have been. We know the sort of event that must have happened for the origin of life.
And what was that?
It was the origin of the first self-replicating molecule.
Right. How did that happen?
I told you, we don't know.
So you have no idea how it started?
No. Nor has anybody.
Nor has anyone else. What do you think is the possibility that intelligent design might turn out to be the answer to some issues in genetics or in evolution?
It could come about in the following way. It could be that at some earlier time, somewhere in the universe, a civilization evolved by probably some kind of Darwinian means to a very, very high level of technology and designed a form of life that they seeded onto perhaps this planet. Now, that is a possibility and an intriguing possibility. Mm. And I suppose it's possible that you might find evidence for that if you look at the details of biochemistry, molecular biology, you might find a signature of some sort of designer.
Wait a second. Richard Dawkins thought intelligent design might be a legitimate pursuit?
And that designer could well be a higher intelligence from elsewhere in the universe. Well, but that higher intelligence would itself have had to have come about by some explicable or ultimately explicable process. It couldn't have just jumped into existence spontaneously. That's the point.
So Professor Dawkins was not against intelligent design, just certain types of designers, such as God.
So the Hebrew God, the God of the Old Testament, he doesn't exist in your view?
Certainly. I mean, that would be a very unpleasant prospect.
So you don't believe in any God anywhere?
Any God anywhere would be completely incompatible with anything that I've said.
I just wanted to make sure. You don't believe in any God anywhere?
No.
What if after you died, you ran into God? He said, what have you been doing, Richard? I mean, what have you been doing? I've been trying to be nice to you.
Yep.
I gave you a multi-million dollar paycheck over and over again with your book, and look what you did.
Bertrand Russell had that point put to him, and he said something like, sir, why did you take such pains to hide yourself?
But if the intelligent design people are right, God isn't hidden. We may even be able to encounter God through science, if we have the freedom to go there. What could be more intriguing than that?
The theory of evolution that was advanced in the 19th century denies this evident fact of creation. This theory holds that the species on Earth were not created by God, but came into being as a result of processes governed entirely by chance. The founder of this theory was an amateur naturalist named Charles Darwin. Darwin expounded this theory in his book, The Origin of Species, which was published in 1859. Darwin's book was an instant success. But its popularity was due more to the ideological implications of the book rather than its scientific worth. Darwin's ideas provided considerable support for the materialistic philosophy which denied the existence of God. The founder of dialectical materialism, Karl Marx, dedicated his book Das Kapital to Darwin and wrote on the cover, "To Charles Darwin, from a devoted admirer." Darwin's theory argued that all species descended from a common ancestor by means of little cumulative changes in long periods of time. Darwin could advance no sound evidence to prove this claim. Indeed, he was himself aware of the great many facts that invalidated his theory. He admitted these in his book in a chapter entitled Difficulties on Theory. Darwin's hope was that these difficulties would be overcome by new scientific discoveries. But in fact, advances in science would refute Darwin's claims one by one. Darwin proposed that all species evolved successively from a common ancestor. But how did that first living thing come into being? Darwin did not address this question at all in his book. He was not even aware that this point was one of the biggest refutations of his theory. The primitive understanding of science in his day assumed that life had a very simple structure. According to a theory called spontaneous generation, which was popular since the medieval age, it was believed that living things could easily arise from non-living matter. It was commonly thought that frogs spontaneously arose from mud and bugs from food leftovers. And some curious experiments were designed to prove these theories. A handful of wheat was left on a rag, and mice were expected to arise from the mixture. The maggots on meat were also taken as evidence that life could generate from non-living matter. But later it was understood that such maggots did not form spontaneously, but that they emerged from microscopic larvae deposited on the meat by flies. And in Darwin's time, the belief that microbes could emanate easily from non-living materials was very common. But 5 years after the publication of The Origin of Species, the famous French biologist Louis Pasteur scientifically refuted these myths that lay ground for evolution. Pasteur, after lengthy studies and experiments, reached this very important conclusion. Can matter organize itself? No. Today there is no circumstance known under which one could affirm that microscopic beings have come into the world without parents resembling themselves. The first evolutionist to take up the issue of the origin of life in the 20th century was the Russian biologist Alexander Oparin. His aim was to explain how the first living cell, the alleged common ancestor of all living beings according to the theory of evolution, could emerge. In the 1930s, Oparin formulated a number of theories to show how the first living cell could arise from inanimate matter by chance. However, his efforts ended in failure, and Oparin himself had to confess. Unfortunately, the origin of the cell remains a question that is actually the murkiest aspect of the whole theory of evolution. Evolutionists that followed Oparin conducted experiments to find an evolutionist explanation to the origin of life. The most famous of these experiments was conducted by the American chemist Stanley Miller in 1953. Miller obtained a few simple organic molecules by triggering a reaction among gases that he claimed would have been present in the primitive Earth atmosphere. At the time, this experiment was regarded as a scientific proof for evolution. It turned out to be no such thing at all. Later discoveries showed that the gases used in the experiment were very different from the gases that had been present in the early atmosphere of the world. Miller himself eventually admitted to the invalidity of his experiment. Every evolutionist attempt in the 20th century to account for the origin of life has ended in failure. Jeffrey Bateman, a professor of geochemistry and a leading advocate of the theory of evolution, confesses this fact in the February 1998 issue of Earth, one of the leading periodicals of evolutionist literature. Today, as we leave the 20th century, we still face the biggest unsolved problem that we had when we entered the 20th century. How did life originate on Earth? The biggest impasse confronting evolution is the incredibly complex structure of the living cell. Every living thing on Earth is made up of cells about a hundredth of a millimeter in size. Some living things are made up of a single cell. Yet even these single cell organisms are remarkably complex in their composition. They have complicated functions to survive, and even little motors to move. In Darwin's time, this complex structure of the cell was unknown. With the primitive microscopes of those days, cells appeared to be little more than featureless stains. However, powerful electron microscopes invented around the middle of the 20th century began revealing just how complex and organized a living cell really was. They laid bare a complexity and organization that could not be a product of chance. A living cell is comprised of thousands of tiny parts that work in harmony. To make a comparison, within the cell, there are power stations, high-tech factories, a complex data bank, huge storage systems, advanced refineries, and a seemingly conscious cell membrane that controls what enters and leaves the cell. In order for the cell to survive, all of these organelles have to exist at the same time. It is impossible that such an intricate and complex system could have emerged as a result of coincidences. Today, not even the most sophisticated laboratory has been able to produce a single living cell from non-living matter. Indeed, this is fully acknowledged to be impossible, and efforts to produce living cells from non-living matter have been abandoned. But the theory of evolution claims that this system, which man with all his intelligence, knowledge, and technology cannot succeed in reproducing, came into existence by chance. Sir Fred Hoyle, a prominent English mathematician and astronomer, explains the impossibility of this with an example. The chance that higher life forms might have emerged by chance is comparable with the chance that a tornado sweeping through a junkyard might assemble a Boeing 747 from the materials therein. Modern biochemistry has also revealed the unimaginably complex design of the DNA molecule. The structure of the DNA molecule was discovered by two scientists, James Watson and Francis Crick, in 1955. Their discovery demonstrated that life was much more complex than anyone had previously envisioned. Himself a confirmed evolutionist, Francis Crick, who received a Nobel Prize for this discovery, came to confess that a structure like DNA could never have emerged by chance. DNA is a giant molecule that exists in the nucleus of the cell. Every detail of a living being's physical and physiological makeup is coded in this double helix. All the information about our bodies, from the color of our eyes to the structure of our internal organs and the shape and function of our cells, are programmed in sections called genes and the DNA. The DNA code is made up of the sequence of four different bases. If we think of each one of these bases as a letter, DNA can be likened to a data bank made up of an alphabet of four letters. All the information about a living thing is stored in this data bank. If we attempt to write down the information in the DNA, this would take up approximately 1 million pages. This is equal to an encyclopedia 40 times bigger than the Encyclopedia Britannica, which is one of mankind's greatest single accumulations of information. But this incredible information is stored in the tiny nucleus of our cells, measuring about 1/1000th of a millimeter in size. It is calculated that a DNA chain small enough to fill a teaspoon has the capacity to store all the information contained in all the books ever written. Of course, such an amazing structure could never have been formed by chance. The theory of evolution, which sees life as the result of mere coincidences and haphazard happenings, is helpless to explain anything in the face of the incredible complexity of DNA. The evolutionist scenario that life generated from non-living matter by chance is disproved by science today. In addition, there is no mechanism in nature to carry out the alleged process called evolution. There is no natural mechanism whereby a single cell can be transformed into a more complex living creature and then go on and become the ancestor of millions of different living species. Darwin proposed a single concept as his evolutionary mechanism, natural selection. The title of his book clearly reveals the importance he gave in this mechanism, the origin of species by means of natural selection. Natural selection is based on the idea that strong individuals that are well adapted to their habitats will survive. For example, in a herd of deer threatened by predators, the ones that can run faster will survive. After a while, the herd will consist mostly of strong, swift individuals as the weaker and slower ones fall prey. However, this mechanism does not cause deer to evolve. It does not transform them into another species. For instance, horses. Natural selection only eliminates weak, disabled, and sick individuals and ensures the permanence and health of a particular species. It has no evolutionary power. Darwin was also aware of this problem. This is why he confessed in The Origin of Species that natural selection can do nothing until favorable variations chance to occur. About the emergence of favorable traits, Darwin was deeply influenced by one of his contemporaries, the French biologist Lamarck. Lamarck thought that living things passed their acquired traits to future generations. In Lamarck's view, giraffes evolved from deer-like creatures. Their necks extended from generation to generation as they tried to reach higher branches for food. Lamarck also believed that if the arms of the members of a family were cut off for generations, the babies would start to be born armless after a while. Darwin, who was quite influenced by these examples, came up with an even bolder claim. In The Origin of Species, He argued that some bears, while trying to hunt in water, evolved into whales. But both Lamarck and Darwin were wrong. Their ideas were contrary to some fundamental laws of biology. In their day, genetics, microbiology, or biochemistry did not exist at all as branches of science. The laws of inheritance were not known at all. Indeed, both Lamarck and Darwin thought that hereditary traits were transferred through the blood. Due to this primitive level of science at the time, the imaginary scenarios of the theory of evolution were not looked upon as odd at all. Darwin's theses had a great impact on the scientific circles of his day. However, Darwin was still distressed. In the chapter, Difficulties on Theory, he wrote, "If it could be demonstrated that any complex organ existed, which could not possibly have been formed by numerous successive slight modifications, my theory would absolutely break down." Darwin's fears proved to be true soon after his death. The laws of inheritance discovered by an Austrian botanist, Gregor Mendel, caused Lamarck's and Darwin's assertions to collapse. The science of genetics that developed at the beginning of the 20th century proved that it was not acquired physical traits, but only genes that were transmitted to subsequent generations. This discovery made it clear that a scenario suggesting that acquired traits accumulated from generation to generation and generated different living species was implausible. In other words, there were no inheritable variations for Darwin's proposed mechanism of natural selection to choose from. Subsequently, the theory of evolution as advanced by Darwin has been collapsed early in the 20th century. All the other efforts by evolutionists in the 20th century could do nothing but only confirm that natural selection had no evolutionary power. A famous evolutionist, the English paleontologist Colin Paterson, admitted this when he said, "No one has ever produced a species by mechanisms of natural selection. No one has ever got near it. And most of the current argument in neo-Darwinism is about this question." Twentieth century science has also demonstrated that there are systems and organs with extremely complicated and intricate mechanisms at work in living beings. These systems and organs will not function even if a single component of them is lacking. This characteristic, called the irreducible complexity of life, is evidence that these structures must have emerged at once and fully formed. This fact definitely demolishes the evolutionist claim that living beings evolved gradually by natural selection through minor changes over time. When it was clear that the mechanism of natural selection proposed by Darwin had no evolutionary power, evolutionists had to make a fundamental change in the theory. In addition to the concept of natural selection, they added a second mechanism called mutation. Mutations are alterations or distortions that take place in the DNA of living beings, mostly as a result of external effects such as radiation or chemical action. The theory of evolution now holds that living things are differentiated from one another and develop as a result of mutations. This cannot be true, for mutations only damage the information in the DNA and give only harm to a living being. No beneficial mutation has yet been observed either in nature or in laboratories. Since mutations do not add new genetic information, it is impossible for living beings to acquire new organs through mutations. No reptile could ever acquire wings, nor could an eyeless creature develop eyes by mutations. For decades, evolutionists subjected different living beings to the effects of radiation and chemicals in an attempt to obtain favorable mutations. What they always ended up with were disabled, deficient, or barren creatures. Countless experiments carried out on fruit flies have shown that the effects of mutations are not beneficial, but rather destructive or fatal. Mutations disrupt the perfect DNA code of a living thing and turn it into a freak of nature. This is why Professor Richard Dawkins, one of the most renowned advocates of the theory of evolution of our day, hesitates when he is asked to give a single example that increases the genetic information.
Professor Dawkins, can you give an example of a genetic mutation or an evolutionary process which can be seen to increase the information in the genome?
Truth is very evident. Life has such a complex design that can never come about by chance. A mechanical watch cannot be formed as a result of the coincidental assembling of cogs, and it proves that there is an intelligent watchmaker. Likewise, life embodies a superior design that proves the existence of a creator who has created it from nothing. The whole universe is the outcome of a flawless creation. The exalted wisdom, power, and knowledge of the creator shows itself in everything he has created. Even the creation of man himself is a miracle that discloses a fact that the theory of evolution strives to sweep out of sight. In the 20th century, the theory of evolution was refuted not only by molecular biology, but also by paleontology, that is, fossil science. No fossil remains supporting evolution have ever been unearthed in excavations conducted in every corner of the world. Fossils are the remains of living beings that have lived in the past. The skeletal structures of living beings whose bodies are rapidly insulated from air can survive intact. These remains give us information about the history of life on Earth. Thus, it is the fossil record that provides scientific answers to the question of the origin of living beings. The theory of evolution claims that all living things descend from a common ancestor. According to the theory, the origination of such diverse living beings took place through minor and successive variations over a very long period of time. The theory argues that first, the unicellular living beings were formed, which then in hundreds of millions of years turned into marine invertebrates and fish, respectively. These fish later had supposedly emerged onto land and turned into reptiles. The story goes further. and says that birds and mammals evolved from reptiles. For this claim to be true, there ought to have been numerous intermediary species linking one living species to another. For instance, if reptiles truly had evolved into birds, then countless half-bird, half-reptile creatures ought to have lived at one time or another. And these intermediary creatures ought to have incomplete, half-developed organs. Darwin called these hypothetical creatures transitional forms. He knew that in order to support his theory, the remains of such intermediate forms had to be found in the fossil record. And the origin of species, he wrote, "If my theory be true, numberless intermediate varieties linking most closely all the species of the same group together must assuredly have existed. Consequently, evidence of their former existence could be found only amongst fossil remains." However, Darwin was aware that the fossil record did not contain any of these hypothetical intermediate forms. This is why he devoted a special chapter to this in his book and posed these troubled questions. Why, if species have descended from other species by fine gradations, do we not everywhere see innumerable transitional forms? But as by this theory, innumerable transitional forms must have existed, why do we not find them embedded in countless numbers in the crust of the earth? Darwin had supposed that such transitional forms would be discovered when the fossil record was inspected more carefully. Subsequently, evolutionists that followed him examined geological layers all around the world for 140 years and looked for these missing fossils. All these efforts ended with great despair. The transitional forms imagined by Darwin remained just that, figments of imagination. English paleontologist Derek Ager admits this fact, though he is an evolutionist. The point emerges that if we examine the fossil record in detail, whether at the level of orders or of species, we find over and over again, not gradual evolution, but the sudden explosion of one group at the expense of another. In strata older than the Cambrian, no fossils of any creatures except a few unicellular organisms are to be seen. In the Cambrian period, however, many diverse species appear quite abruptly. More than 30 invertebrate species, such as jellyfish, starfish, trilobites, and snails, emerge all of a sudden. These living beings have complex body systems, such as the circulatory system, and also very complex organs. For instance, the eye of the trilobite is made of hundreds of honeycomb-like cells, each having a double lens system. It is a wonder of design. This is the first eye that appeared on the earth, and it definitely refutes the Darwinist claim that life evolved from the very primitive towards the complex. Modern insects such as bees and dragonflies have the same eye structure as did the trilobite. According to the theory of evolution, species must have evolved from pre-existing forms. However, there is no other complex life form known to have existed before the trilobites and other species of the Cambrian period. The Cambrian species came into existence all of a sudden, without any ancestors. A well-known advocate of the theory of evolution, the English zoologist Richard Dawkins, makes the following confession on the subject. "It is as though the species of the Cambrian were just planted there without any evolutionary history." This situation refutes the theory of evolution for sure, because Darwin wrote in The Origin of Species, "If numerous species belonging to the same genera or families have really started into life all at once, the fact would be fatal to the theory of descent with slow modification through natural selection." This fatal stroke that frightened Darwin comes from the Cambrian period, right at the outset of the fossil record. In all fossil layers after the Cambrian, living species always appear abruptly and fully formed. The main taxa, such as fish, amphibians, reptiles, birds, and mammals, and the hundreds of thousands of different species within them, all appeared suddenly in distinct structures. There is not even a single transitional form between any groups, as evolutionists imagine.
It's tough to say, because we're not dealing with a theory in any sense in which, say, a physicist would recognize the theory. We're dealing with a collection of anecdotes, a certain point of view, a series of hunches. I would say that the most outstanding, the salient points are, first of all, the fossil record, which is simply mystifying. We can't make much sense of the fossil record. It does not sustain any kind of Darwinian prediction that can be intelligently derived from Darwinian theory, and it doesn't seem to sustain anything else as far as I can see. It's a perfectly mystifying record. That's one obvious point. I'm not talking just about the Cambrian explosion. I'm talking about everything that doesn't make a whole lot of sense in the fossil record. Second point, we have never been able in any way theoretically to examine the central Darwinian claim that natural selection and random variation can account for a great deal of complexity. If you look at the history of physics, for example, what did Newton do in the 17th century? He said, well, the planets are being attracted to the sun by a force. It's not any kind of force, it's a inverse square force. And then he went and showed that if you make that assumption, the result will be an orbit that conforms exactly to the observed orbit, say, of the Earth or of Mars. It will be a conic section. And then he proved the converse, that if it's a conic section, the planets must be attracted to a central source by an inverse square law. There is nothing like that in biology, in Darwinian theory. A kind of a canonical demonstration that this mechanism, random variation, natural selection, is adequate to the generation of this level of complexity. From the point of view of the serious sciences, without that kind of a demonstration, one is completely adrift. You have no idea whether the mechanism is adequate for its intended purposes. This is the second point. Third evidential piece of the puzzle. Look, you turn to the serious sciences, you turn to general relativity or quantum mechanics. I can program a computer with the equations of general relativity or with the equations of quantum mechanics, and I can say, all right, what are the consequences? I can actually see the consequences emerge in a simulation. We can't do any of this in biology. And that should prompt any reasonable person to ask, why not? If this is such a simple mechanism, which could easily be programmed on a computer, how come we can't set up a computer and create something of biological-like complexity? How come we cannot see the unfolding of an evolutionary process the way we can see the unfolding of an evolutionary process in physics? This is a very serious question. I've looked at all the genetic algorithms. I'm trying to write a genetic algorithm myself. And the sheer fact is, without a tremendous amount of very special manipulation and ad hoc constraints, the computer is not going to generate anything realistic if it uses Darwinian mechanisms, and it will generate something realistic only if it doesn't use Darwinian mechanisms. This is an important point. 50 years after the computer revolution began, we have a splendid tool for assessing the intelligibility and viability of Darwinian theory. And everything that we know, and I think this is the uniform experience of anyone working in genetic algorithms, indicates these mechanisms will not work. They will not work for their intended purposes. And finally, there's the utter absence of laboratory evidence. I mean, random variation, natural selection, we should be able to stop manipulating organisms. When we look at dogs, no matter how far back we go, it's dogs. When we look at bacteria, no matter what we do, they stay bugs. They don't change in their fundamental nature. There seems to be some sort of an inherent species limitation, and we have no good explanation for this in terms of Darwinian theory. We should have far more flexibility, far more plasticity under laboratory conditions than we actually do if Darwinian theory or anything like that were correct. What we see in nature, what we see in the laboratory, is very highly bounded variation, cyclic variation. That's, for example, finch beaks in the Galapagos Island. That's about all we see. Small variations. Why is that if Darwinian theory is correct? These are evidentiary points that I think need to be stressed, need to be examined openly, honestly. And they never are, of course. Never are.
A major problem in proving the theory has been the fossil record. This record has never revealed traces of Darwin's hypothetical intermediate variants. Instead, species appear and disappear abruptly. And this anomaly has fueled the creationist argument that each species was created by God. On the other hand, there have been a few fossils that were touted as transitional forms by evolutionists, but later turned out to be nothing of the sort. One of the most important of these alleged transitional forms was the fossil of a fish called a coelacanth. For years, evolutionists claimed that this creature, which was only known in the fossil record, had characteristics similar to those of land-dwelling animals. It had, they argued, primitive legs and a primitive lung. These evolutionist claims about the coelacanth were advanced as a scientific fact, and imaginary drawings picturing the animal crawling onto land from water made their way even to textbooks. It came as a great shock to evolutionists when a living example of the supposedly extinct coelacanth was caught in the Indian Ocean in 1938. It was then seen that the fish was no different from the fish of our day. Contrary to the claims of evolutionists, coelacanths had neither legs nor primitive lungs. What was worse, the coelacanth, supposedly a creature readying itself to make the leap from sea to land, was in reality a fish that lived only in the deep waters of the oceans, never approaching to within 180 meters of the surface. Another alleged transitional form has been a fossil bird called Archaeopteryx. For decades, evolutionists argued that this creature was an intermediary between reptiles and birds. However, the seventh Archaeopteryx fossil, discovered in 1992, revealed that the creature had a sternum. That is, the chest bone essential for flight muscles. This proved that the animal was a perfect flying bird. The evolutionist claims about the claw-like nails on the wings of the Archaeopteryx also failed, since similar structures were also discovered in modern birds like the Hoatzin. Because of such reasons, one of the foremost defenders of the theory of evolution, the Harvard paleontologist Stephen Jay Gould, had to admit that Archaeopteryx could not be considered as a transitional form. When we examine the structures of different animal groups, we can see that it is impossible for an evolutionary process to have occurred between them. For instance, it is impossible for fish that have their respiratory systems, excretory systems, muscle structures, and metabolisms completely designed to live in water to have transformed into land-dwelling animals by stepping out of the water. Living groups on land are also all very different from one another. Evolutionists claim that birds evolved from reptiles by random mutations. However, reptiles are cold-blooded, whereas birds are warm-blooded. The bodies of birds are covered with complexly structured feathers, whereas the bodies of reptiles are covered with scales that bear no similarity to feathers. Birds have a lung system that is unlike that of any other land-dwelling animal. The aerodynamic properties of the bird wings cannot be explained by evolution at all. It is impossible for wings to have gradually developed, as evolutionists claim, because a half-developed wing is not an advantage, but a fatal disadvantage. Evolutionists also claim that some reptiles transformed into mammals. However, these two living groups are also very distinct from each other. Reptiles lay eggs, while mammals give birth to their offspring. As opposed to the scales of reptiles, the bodies of mammals are covered with fur. The lactation mechanism is peculiar to mammals, and evolutionists can never explain its origin. Faced with these realities made clear by the fossil record, evolutionists directed all their attention to the claim that man evolved from ape-like creatures. 6,500 different ape species have lived so far, and the majority of them are extinct. The skulls of these extinct apes, both big and small, constituted a great resource for evolutionists on which to exercise their imaginations freely. Arranging the skulls of these extinct ape species from the smallest to the biggest, and adding some skulls of vanished human races to the series, evolutionists concocted the scenario of human evolution. The most important role of this scenario is given to the extinct ape species called Australopithecus. The first Australopithecus fossil was found in 1924 by a paleontologist named Raymond Dart. Since then, evolutionists argue that this ape species, the name of which means southern ape, is a man-like creature. However, when Australopithecus and chimpanzee skeletons are compared, it is seen that there is no important difference between the two. In the face of this fact, evolutionists hypothesized that Australopithecus walked upright on its 2 feet differently from other apes. However, two world-renowned anatomists, Lord Sally Zuckerman and Professor Charles Oxnard, refuted this allegation. Simply put, Australopithecus, advanced as the ancestor of man by evolutionists, is merely an extinct ape species. On the other hand, fossils that are included by evolutionists under imaginary classifications, such as Homo erectus, Homo ergaster, or Homo sapien archaic, in fact belong to different human races. When these fossils are inspected, it is seen that their skeletons are essentially the same as those of people living today. The only dissimilarities are a few structural differences in their skulls. But differences like these are to be found in different human races alive on Earth today. The famous evolutionist paleontologist Richard Leakey admits that the difference between the skulls classified as Homo erectus and those of modern men is only racial. These differences are probably no more pronounced than we see today between the separate geographical races of modern humans. The only defense left to evolutionists against all these scientific facts is just one thing: propaganda. The baseless scenario of the human evolution is imposed on the public by means of imaginary drawings that appear in evolutionist publications. In these drawings, creatures with hairy bodies and simian features are decked out with overtones of human-like motifs. The given impression is that these half-man, half-ape transitional forms did live once. From time to time, drawings that present snapshots from the social life of these creatures are made. These misleading drawings are introduced in a particular sequence to engrave the scenario of the human evolution on the subconscious of society. Even in the most famous scientific publications, there frequently appear such window dressings called reconstructions and imaginary family tree drawings made by their inspiration. The imaginative power of evolutionists is not limited to fictional drawings and models. They go even further and shoot movies in which imaginary half-man, half-ape creatures act. However, all of these are pure deception. The only evidence at hand is generally nothing more than a few skull fragments or a tibia. The hair, skin, nose, ears, lips, or other facial features of a living being cannot be determined from its bone remains. Evolution has shaped these soft tissues, which leave no trace in the fossil, to suit the purposes of their theory and produce imaginary reconstructions in their workshops. Ernest Houghton from Harvard University states that these drawings have no scientific value. You can, with equal facility, model on a Neanderthaloid skull the features of a chimpanzee or the lineaments of a philosopher. These alleged restorations of ancient types of man have very little, if any, scientific value and are likely only to mislead the public. Evolutionists go so far in this subject that they can even invent very different faces for the same skull. The three entirely different reconstructions made for the fossil called Zinzanthropus is a famous example showing how persistent evolutionists are in producing these false masks. Evolutionists engage not only in drawing and modeling tricks, sometimes they commit deliberate forgeries. The most famous of these frauds is the Piltdown fossil, introduced in England in 1912 by an evolutionist named Charles Dawson. This fossil was presented as the most important transitional form between ape and man and was displayed in museums for more than 30 years. Experts who re-examined the fossil in 1949 discovered that it was a forgery that had been produced by attaching an orangutan's jaw to a human skull. Another intermediate transitional form fabricated by evolutionists was the Nebraska Man. This was cooked up in 1922 on the basis of a single fossil tooth. The evolutionists did not neglect to give it an ostentatious Latin name, Hesperopithecus Harold-Cooka, or to make imaginary drawings related to it. It was soon revealed that the tooth that had been the source of inspiration for Nebraska Man, in fact, belonged to a wild pig. Many other fossil skulls have been presented as great evidence for evolution failed one by one. Neanderthal man was advanced as evidence in 1856, dismissed in 1960. Piltdown man was advanced as evidence in 1912, dismissed in 1953. Zinzanthropus was advanced as evidence in 1959, dismissed in 1960. Ramapithecus was advanced as evidence in 1964, dismissed in 1979. Despite all these facts, these skulls are still presented to the public through the media and in some evolutionist textbooks as if they were scientific facts. In many countries, an important part of the society supposes that evolution is a proven fact. A great deal of this so-called evidence of evolution, much of which has been dismissed by evolutionists themselves, is still presented to school children in their textbooks, where they are depicted as the ancestors of man. In fact, the truth that the evolutionists try so hard to deny and conceal is there for all to see. Species appeared all of a sudden and perfectly on the earth. That is, they were created. The divine creator, ruling over the whole of nature, created all kinds with their unique and perfect traits. He is the Lord of the heavens, the earth, and all that is between them. The whole universe is the outcome of a flawless creation. The exalted wisdom, power, and knowledge of the Creator shows itself in everything he has created.
What many also don't know is that the basic idea of evolution did not originate with Charles Darwin. According to Mackey's Encyclopedia of Freemasonry, it originated with his grandfather, Erasmus Darwin. Dr. Erasmus Darwin was the first man in England to suggest those ideas which were later to be embodied in the Darwinian theory by his grandson, Charles Darwin, who wrote in 1859, Origin of Species. Now, Erasmus Darwin was the founder of the Masonic Lunar Society. According to author Ian Taylor, the Lunar Society was active from about 1764 to 1800, and its prominent influence continued long afterwards under the banner of the British Royal Society. In 1794, Erasmus Darwin wrote a book called Zoonomia, where he expanded upon his theory of evolution. It was based on the occult concept of becoming, the gradual process of attaining godhood. Even before then, however, John Locke, a prominent Freemason and member of the British Royal Society, had taken the Hindu idea of reincarnation, which had been brought to Britain by the East India Trading Company, and formulated his own ideas on evolution based on it. The British Royal Society accepted his ideas, and they also received the support of the male members of the Darwin family at the time. 2 centuries later, this occult concept of becoming would be transmitted to Charles Darwin, and the Origin of Species would be born. So the evolutionary theory clearly had occult roots that predated Charles Darwin by a long way. These occult ideas were developed by Freemasons before Darwin brought it to public attention with his book. Could the origin of life be explained without God? That was the key question. Well, after scientific testing, the idea of spontaneous generation was quickly destroyed and proved to be impossible by the law of biogenesis. It just couldn't happen. Dr. George Wald, a Nobel Prize-winning evolutionist in the field of biology and Professor Emeritus of Biology at Harvard University. There are only 2 possibilities as to how life arose. One is spontaneous generation arising to evolution. The other is a supernatural creative act of God. There is no third possibility. Spontaneous generation, that life arose from non-living matter, was scientifically disproved 120 years ago by Louis Pasteur and others. That leaves us with the only possible conclusion that life arose as a creative act of God. I will not accept that philosophically because I do not want to believe in God. Therefore, I choose to believe in that which I know is scientifically impossible. All evidence still pointed towards some kind of mind being behind the world. Charles Darwin himself unconsciously revealed this in statements like, "Natural selection picks out with unerring skill the best varieties." Statements like these suggest that nature has a mind. Only something with a mind can pick out or make any kind of decision at all. And if we're talking about something with a mind, what we're actually talking about is God.